But it is now with great pleasure to introduce our next speaker who has earned a worldwide reputation as a PKPD modeling expert, especially Geraldine Ariel, who is the Vice President of Applications at our Lixoft division at Simulations Plus, is going to be speaking on the topic of using a population mechanistic TMDD model calibrated on preclinical monkey data to simulate first in human. Geraldine, take it away.
Thanks for the introduction. So exactly what I'm going to show you today is an example of how to really use entirely your preclinical monkey data to plan first in human. So the challenge when planning first in human is, of course, to choose a dose right. You want it to be safe and still pretty close to a dose having an effect. A classical approach to choose a dose is to use a NOAEL approach, no observable adverse effect level. And the idea of it is to determine this dose, NOAEL dose, in several preclinical species, then scale the dose to human based on body weight or body surface area, and then apply a safety margin, for instance, tenfold. But in the late years, this approach has been proven not to always be very safe, especially for biologics. And one reason is that it focuses on the dose rather than the effect. So over the last years, there has been a shift, and instead of the NOAEL, the MABEL approach has been promoted. It stands for Minimal Anticipated Biological Effect Level. And as the name is saying, it requires to understand the biological effect, so the PD. And to understand the PD, one nice way is a PKPD modeling approach that can really give valuable insights. So the question I'm going to address in this presentation is, can we accurately predict the human PK and PD to determine the MABEL using a model fitted on preclinical data? As an example, I'm going to use the preclinical monkey PK data that I have extracted from this publication and that you can see here. The drug is an IgG2 antibody that is directed against human ALK1 receptor. ALK1 is a cell surface type 1 receptor of the TGF-beta receptor family. It is expressed on endothelial cells as well as various solid tumors. And it has been proposed as an anti-angiogenic target. So what we're going to try to do is to develop a model on this preclinical monkey PK data and then scale the model and try to predict the human PK and also, if possible, the PD. Doing a prediction is always simple. What is hard is to do a correct prediction. So what we're going to do is to compare our prediction to the actual phase one data that has already been published to check if our prediction is correct or not. So the workflow that we're going to follow is to first develop a population PK/PD model on the preclinical monkey data. We're going to use the Monolix application of the Monolix suite to do so. Then we're going to scale the estimated monkey parameters to humans, and finally use the scaled model to predict the human PK and PD for various dose levels using the Simulix application of the Monolix suite. So what I'm going to do first is to show you how all this works in Monolix. So here I have opened the Monolix application and I have opened my first run. So I have loaded the data set and I can right away show you how the data looks like. So that's our preclinical monkey data. Some individuals have received multiple doses and some just a single dose. I'm here looking at the drug concentration on log scale, and the dotted lines represent the time of the dose. What I can see is that I see here the typical curvature of a two-compartment model, and here's a typical downward curvature of a nonlinear mechanism. So what I'm gonna do is to try to fit a population PK model to this data set and then use a model to predict what happens in humans. To do it, to start simple, I will first use a linear PK model and we're going to see what it gives. And if it's not enough, we can change afterwards. So what I have done next is I went to the structural model tab and I have selected from our PK library of models, models with two compartments and a linear elimination. I have chosen some initial parameter values. I have set up the statistical model and I have run everything. And as everything has already run, I can show you right away the estimated parameter values that are here. So I have fixed effects that represent the typical behavior in the population and standard deviations of the random effects that represent the inter-individual variability from one monkey to another one. I can also have a look at the diagnostic plots. I can in particular look at the individual fits. So I see the dots represent the data and the line, the model fit for each individual. And we can see that actually it's not so bad. I can also have a look at the ops versus spread. And here I see some deviation for the small concentrations. And this is because I have not taken into account this non-linearity that I see in the data. But nevertheless, let's see what we can do with this model. And that's a visual predictive check that looks not too bad. So this is what I have obtained when I have fitted the linear PK model on the preclinical data. Now the next step is actually to scale these parameters that I have obtained in monkey to represent human parameters. And this will be done actually outside of the Monolix suite. I will just show you on the slides. So that's the parameters I have estimated on monkey, and actually K, K12, and K21 are rates. So to scale them, I will just do an allometric scaling based on the typical weight of humans and the typical weight of monkeys with an exponent of minus 0.25. If you are wondering about this minus 0.25, just think that it is actually equivalent to considering for the clearance an exponent of 0.75 and for the volume an exponent of 1. As the rate is a ratio of the two, you end up with an exponent of minus 0.25. So that's what we're going to do with these three parameters and obtain these typical values in humans. And for the volume, actually the volume for IEGs in humans is pretty well known, so I can just take the typical volume value for IEGs in humans. So now I would like to perform a simulation with different dose levels using the model I have estimated and these parameters here. And to do so, I'm going to use the Simulix application. And actually what I can do is that I can export my Monolix run from Monolix to Simulix. So I have clicked here on the button export to Simulix, and this will open the Simulix application and really transfer all the information to Simulix, in particular regarding the model I have used. So here I have everything that have been transferred. So here, for example, I have the model, I have the population parameters. The population parameters I see here, for the moment, they represent monkeys. So what I need to do is actually to create new parameters that correspond to humans. So what I'm going to do is to duplicate this element. I'm going to call it human parameters, and I will change the value. So for the volume, we said we want 40 ml per kilogram, for K 0.1, for K 12, 0.39, and for K 21, 0.28. And for the inter-individual variability, we will just assume it remains the same. So I can click OK. So now I have my human parameters. What I also need to define are the different treatments I would like to try. So actually I can create several treatments elements where I would give the time of the dose. So let's just consider a single dose and the amount. Actually, I want to create several of them. I will not do it in front of you. I will just open a run where I have already prepared everything. So I'm loading the run so that I can show you what I have done. So in the treatment here, you see I have created several treatment elements. It goes from 0.85 milligram per kilogram to 15 milligram per kilogram, each time just a single dose. And then I have prepared the simulation in the simulation tab by creating several simulation groups. Each group receives one of the different treatments I have defined. I'm going to generate within each group 200 individuals by sampling individual parameter values using the population parameters that now represent humans. And I'm going to output the drug concentration over time. When I run this, I'm going to end up with a plot like this, where I can see the predicted PK concentration over time in humans for the different dose groups I have tried. So for now, I have a prediction. Now the key question is this prediction correct? So what I would like to do is actually to overlay the actual phase one data that has been published on top of these predictions. And this is for the moment not possible within the Simulix application. So I have a small R script I have used to do so, and I will show it to you on the slides. So here is what I can see if I overlay the phase one data published in this publication on top of my predictions. So I have extracted the data from the plot, and actually each dot here is the average over six individuals. And when I overlay it, you see that for the high doses, I have actually a very good agreement between the model prediction and the actual phase one first in human data. But for the lower doses, not anymore. And this is probably because I have not captured the nonlinear behavior of the PK. At the high doses, it's a linear behavior that dominates. This is well captured and well predicted. But at the low doses, the nonlinear behavior starts to become more important. And this is not well captured and not well predicted. So we need to go one step further. And to go one step further, what we can do is, instead of using a linear PK model, we can use a nonlinear PK model with a target-mediated drug disposition model. So actually what we're going to do is to go back to step one and choose a better PK model to capture our monkey data. So I have taken a very simple TMDD model first. So in addition to the linear elimination, I have added the nonlinear elimination with parameters Vm and Km. In the MonoX suite, we have a very nice library of TMDD models. So I have just picked this model from the library and run again. These are the parameters that I have obtained. So now, So these are the estimated parameters, and we can also have a look at the diagnostic plots. So here I have the individual fits, and you see that this time, the typical TMDD shape with a downward curvature here is much better taken into account. The VPC looks better too, and the observations versus prediction plot also. So now step two will be to scale these parameters to predict human. For the linear PK parameters, I will proceed exactly as before. And I also need to scale Vm and Km. And actually this is pretty hard because Vm and Km are more phenomenological parameters that have no clear mechanistic meaning. So it's really hard to decide how they should scale from monkey to human. So to keep it simple, I have assumed that they are the same between monkey and humans. So here are my human parameters, and I can use them to do exactly the same as before, predict what would happen for different dose levels and overlay with the actual data. And when I do this, this is what I obtain. And again, I see that for the high doses, the agreement is pretty good, but for the low doses, it's not really so good. And in this case, actually, it's a bit opposite compared to the previous one. Our prediction is lower compared to the actual data. And probably this happens because I have not scaled the Vm and Km parameters properly. But these parameters are really hard to scale and hard to decide how to handle them. So maybe what I could do is, instead of using this more phenomenological TMDD model, I could switch to a more mechanistic model where it will be easier to understand the meaning of the parameters and how to scale them. So again, back to step one. And this time I'm going to use a mechanistic TMDD model where I'm saying that my monoclonal antibody binds to the target. The target is produced and degraded. When it binds, it creates a complex that can get internalized. You see that here I have much more parameters to estimate. So I have done a small sensitivity analysis. And here I have displayed the typical concentration time curve, and the arrows show where each of these parameters has an impact. And on top of it, I have overlaid the single dose monkey data we have. And what you can see is that actually I have data in all this part of the curve. So all these parameters will be probably identifiable from the monkey data. But for kint and kd, I have actually no data in the portion of the curve where they have an influence. So probably these two parameters, they will not be identifiable from the monkey PK data. But I thought, okay, maybe I can find some value in the literature for those parameters. And actually I have been lucky because I could indeed find some values. So for monkeys, I could find a value for kint and kd. And for human, I could even also find a value for kd, so the internalization rate of the free receptor. So actually what I have done is to fit again this more mechanistic TMDD model to the preclinical monkey data, but instead of estimating all parameters, I have fixed kint and kdeg to the experimental values from the literature. And after running this, these are the estimated parameters. So again, the next step will be to scale these parameters to humans. Oh, sorry, I was again one step too fast. So let's have a look at how the model fits. So we see that the individual fits again looks very good. Same for the VPC and same for the observation spread. So the model, even if I have fixed two of the parameters to literature values, is really able to properly capture the monkey PK data. Next step, scaling of the parameters. So same for the linear PK parameters, I proceed as before. For kint, kdeg, and kd, it's actually very easy because I have some experimental value for humans. So I can just fix it to the experimental value. And then I'm left with R0, which is the ALK1 target concentration. And actually ALK1 is expressed on endothelial cells. So I have assumed that the apparent target concentration that the drug sees is the same in monkey and in human. So that's now my parameters for humans, and I can use them to simulate what happens for different dose levels. And here are my predictions overlaid with the data. And this time, you see that our prediction is nicely in line with the data. The prediction interval is pretty large because I have a lot of variability from one individual to another one, but I'm in the right range. So with this model, I'm able to correctly predict the human PK after having scaled the parameters. That is the first step, the PK, but I'm more interested in the PD. And what is very nice with this more mechanistic TMDD model is that actually I can simulate what happens for any of the variable that appears in the model. And what I can do is to simulate what is the ALK1 concentration over time. I can look at the free ALK1 concentration divided by the baseline, for instance, and this can be considered as a surrogate of the biological effect, so kind of the percent inhibition of my target. So if I do this, I get a plot like this. So I start at time zero at one, and then when the drug is applied, the fraction of free receptor decreases actually to almost zero for all the dose levels I have tested so far. And depending on the dose level, it either stays for zero really over several days or it can recover. Actually, this is really a huge effect, a huge target inhibition, like almost completely. If I want to just have to choose a dose that just has a small effect, I really need to go down in the dose levels. So I have simulated four additional dose levels with smaller doses. And if, for example, I assume that I want to achieve a 10% inhibition of my target, I could choose a dose that would be around 0.005 milligram per kilogram. This could be considered as a MABEL and as a starting dose for the first in human. So in this workflow, I have used actually three different models of different complexities, and which each of them I have tried to predict what happens in humans. All of the models were able to predict the high doses where the PK is linear, but only the mechanistic TMDD model was able to also correctly predict the low doses where I have the nonlinear behavior that takes over. Actually, what is very nice with this more mechanistic model is that it also allows me to predict what happens for the target and to simulate target occupancy, for instance. Which model to choose always depends on the goal at the end. If you would like to use a model to predict first in human without having the first in human data, of course, then what would you do? Actually, there have been some guidelines published in the literature, here put the reference, that shows this nice chart that guides you depending on the type of individuals you're going to have for your first in human, healthy or not. Is the linear, is the PK you see in monkeys linear or not? Do you have some literature information for the PK parameters related to the TMDD behavior or not? And depending on what you have, you can do a more complex or more simple approach. I have followed this path here using a TMDD model to predict what happens in humans, and it has worked very nicely. So we have used at the end a mechanistic TMDD model. We have scaled the parameters to represent human. For the linear PK parameters, I have used a simple allometric scaling based on body weight. For the TMDD parameters, I have fixed them to experimental values, and I was lucky to have them. And by doing so, I could successfully predict the human PK of this drug. And even more, we could use the model to simulate target occupancy to determine the MABEL, and this really helps to guide the choice of the first in human dose. Thank you very much. And I think we have quite some time for questions.
Very nice job, Geraldine. Thank you so much. As Geraldine mentioned, there is a couple minutes remaining for questions. And as a reminder, you may type your question using the questions panel in the Excel events platform. There is one to start, and it's really, Geraldine, a multi-part question. So I'm going to do my best to not have it be sounding like a run-on sentence here. Okay. Are there more sensitive parameters within different drug classes to key in on when building the TMDD model? For example, for a monoclonal antibody, are there starting points for evaluating whether target expression levels, turnover rates, or key drug-specific parameters will be of greater impact when building the models? And is this something which can be evaluated and or automated within Monolix?
So, like for several class of drugs, for example, monoclonal antibodies, we have some like ranges of typical parameter values. And once you know what is a typical range of your parameter, you can investigate the impact of the parameter on either like on the model prediction. It can be like what it would give in monkey or what it would give in humans. And actually, this is something that I have done but not shown in this presentation, is really to check in this prediction what happens if our estimate for KD is a bit off, or what happens if our estimate for Kint is a bit off. And this really can be done very easily by just manually playing with the parameter values. if I go back to the Simulix interface, here we have the exploration tab. And in the exploration tab, here you can like really interactively fix the first prediction and then check, okay, what is going on if my parameter for K is, for example, a bit lower or a bit higher. So this is can be done in a like more manual exploratory way, but it can also be automatized. Everything we do via the graphical user interface can also be scripted using R functions. And there you can really like script to just change all parameters by a certain percentage and check what's the results. So of course, that's an important point to really try to find out what is the impact of your parameter values and of the uncertainty of the parameter estimates on your prediction.
Very good, very good. Another question has come in. Your title of the presentation deals with first in human predictions, but your presentation did use human data as part of the model selection process, the phase one data. If human data were totally absent, nothing available, what would you do differently?
Yeah, no, I fully agree that this example was like more a retrospective example where I had both the preclinical data and the human data to check if my model prediction was correct or not. But it is an interesting example because it shows you what is possible or what is not. And as I mentioned at the very end, actually, if you have no human data, then you can rely on this chart to decide. And it really depends what kind of information you have. If, for example, your preclinical monkey data is linear, just make it simple with a linear PK model with simplified allometry and go for this. If you see that it's not linear, if you can get some information about the parameter values from literature or from other types of experiments, then it can make sense to go with a TMDD model and you will have probably enough information to parameterize it. If it's not the case, then go with the simpler one. So this chart is really a summary of, depending on the preclinical data you have, only preclinical, how would you proceed to predict humans?
Very good. I think that takes us right up to the time limit. Thank you again, Geraldine, for the really, really great and insightful presentation.
Thank you. Bye-bye.